The last parish I served as rector in the Diocese of Chicago, St. James, had, like this sanctuary, had clear glass, but the driveway was on, if you were going down the aisle on the right side, and I'd come to do the main service and look around and I'd kind of, wait, where is everybody today? And as the opening hymn was going, I'd see these cars coming by, parking lot in the rear. And you know, I'd get to the altar, reverence the altar, and turn around like, oh, here you all are. And when we were moving towards this day, the last several days, I think it's fair to say the staff was a bit anxious about attendance. And I should have remembered the great truth of the Episcopal Church, don't worry, they'll all be here by the gospel. And here you are, so all is well. I'm going to begin with a prayer, if I can, by William Skerritt. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, who in thy holy writ has likened unto a potter working at his wheel, taking the unformed clay and molding it into a likeness pleasing to him, who if a flaw is revealed in the vessel or a distortion or a weakness, does not cast it aside as useless or of no account, but doth put it again on the wheel, patiently shaping it towards beauty. So take us and use us, thy faltering children. Bring us under the discipline of thy love and thy justice. Confirm and fulfill in us thine intent. Mold us into the likeness of women and men thou meant us to be. And grant us continual growth in knowledge and love of thee, and a courageous dedication to thy will. Amen. I like that image of molding, of being formed, of being a vessel, both as individuals of God, carrying God's word in us, and also the vessel of our community, our church in its totality, but also in our several different congregational realities. When the news of my own transition was shared, folks suggested that I be with you all and talk about ministry and transition. And I guess that's sort of a broad theme for what I want to share, but I want to, as you'll see in just a moment, move that into really what is all of our ministry and all of our time. And then I'll circle back at the end and share some particular reflections of this time of ministry and transition for our diocesan community. And I'm not going to try and avoid, especially when I get into what I hope will be the meat of this time, to not be just a talking head. So I may ask you all some questions in the midst of this and ask for some back and forth. And if somebody just can't help themselves, I mean in a positive way, and wants to interrupt me and ask a question, please do. Just, you know, if you want to interrupt me and take over the presentation, please don't. So, I don't have another opportunity like this. I'm going to hold on to it for dear life. So, but seriously, when I wrote the community of the diocese and shared with them that I was going to be leaving, I found myself leaning back on the words of wisdom I heard 10 years ago from Duncan Gray. And Duncan Gray, he's now retired. I knew Duncan Gray as the Bishop of Mississippi when I was a college student, but it was his father. And his father's father was Duncan Gray as well, and he was once a Bishop of Mississippi. So this is a family that knows Episcopal transitions. And in the stormy times of 2006, when the church was abuzz over issues of human sexuality, and we had just elected a new presiding bishop, Duncan Gray, still in his active ministry, having just ordained his son a transitional deacon, brought a prayer book into the House of Bishops. And we all bring prayer books in the House of Bishops. I don't want you to think that's a particularly... We actually also have the Bible open in the House of Bishops. These are all good things. But he brought one that he had actually had the new presiding bishop, not yet installed, Catherine Shepherd Shorey, sign for his newly ordained son. And his comment was to us, "I am an interim bishop. I have this prayer book signed to give to my son. The future is his. I'm the past. We're bridges from the ones that came before us to those who come after." And I've been bishop like 15 minutes, you know. But I thought to myself at that moment, oh my gosh, he's right. That's what we're supposed to do. That's how we're supposed to behave. This is not ours. It's a stewardship that we hold, whether it's the episcopate, the presbyterate, the diaconate, or the baptism of all members of the body of Christ. We are here for a while. We are stewards of this sacred body, the church. And the church exists to do God's mission. And what we're supposed to do is carry this, having received it from the saints of old, and take it to the saints of tomorrow. And so while I'm thinking actively about the handoff, if you will, we all need to be thinking that way. And so I'm particularly focused on trying to do that well. And so part of, I think, what I want to be in conversation with you today is, how are we always thinking about living in this time between times? In a really positive and rich way, celebrating what we've received and being excited about what we get to hand off. So, that's who we are. Exercising a ministry, fundamental ministry of stewardship. Stewardship of this sacred body. Now, how many of you all have sat in workshops I've done here at school for the Leadership Academy on vestry wardens before? A few of you all have. Okay. So you won't be surprised that I'm going to begin by talking about the duties of trusteeship. Right? Okay. And you all, shall I sit down and let you all do this lesson? No. Okay. And I want to do this because it's fundamental to who we are as leaders on vestries and bishops' committees that we act as a trustee. And again, going back to what I was just talking about, stewardship. Those of you who are on vestries, you are members of a board of directors of a corporation, a religious corporation in the state of California or in the state of Arizona. You humans out there would be in Arizona. That's an important thing to just note because you not only have a spiritual responsibility, you also have a corporate responsibility. Bishops committee members, while you don't carry that legal entity and the care for that, the corporate body, the diocese, invites you to act on their behalf in a similar fiduciary way. And so the three duties I want to underscore for all of us are these. You first have the duty of care. You care for the corporate body. You care, and when I say corporate, that can sound kind of like, oh, this is like IBM or Exxon. Corpus, the body. You care for that community. And everything you do needs to be in its best and vital interests. A failure of care of ministry could be to neglect the physical property. It could be to not handle the budget in a careful way. It could be a whole host of those sort of ways that you simply do the efficient and caring work of a community. The other two duties are equally important. You'll see how these all intertwine. The duty of obedience. Now, That sounds fun, doesn't it? It actually is so important, and it's such an important part of health. In this community, we have a duty of obedience to, well, I'm just going to see what you, and maybe those of you who've taken this course before sit on your hands. But let's think, what might we need to be obedient to? Anybody?
God.
Well, yeah, but what does that look like? Yeah, thank you, Jesus, right. But what does that look like? You know, how does it, how do you make sure you're doing that? In the church, how do we, what are some of the markers for this?
The will of the community.
Let me get a little bit more specific. What? Prayer? You all are so spiritual.
Biblical teaching.
You get, this is like, you know, when are you getting warmer? David.
Canons.
Canons of the church, you know. The canons, and all that you said, prayer, scripture, the canons aren't unrooted from that. They are informed by the elemental parts of being a Christian community, but they codify it in a way that you can kind of see how you're doing. What else? The bishop is what you said. The canons would talk about the relationship between a congregation and the bishop, and in that sense, yes. Thank you. The law of
the city, the state,
and the
nation.
Federal, state, and local law. And one place that gets can be kind of nettlesome is around employment law, for example, around laws that prescribe what you can and cannot do as a not-for-profit entity, etc., etc. Canons, if I can go back quick, two sets of canons. We have our Episcopal Church canons, the canons that go over the whole Episcopal Church, and we have our Diocesan canons, which actually give a bit more specificity. And then at the local parish or mission level, we have bylaws, yeah, which are all important. And you might say, golly, these, you know, the jots and the tittles are endless. As I'll say more about this in a bit, these create very, very important guides and boundaries. And a lot of questions that you might want to ask, they're great places to start. To see, you know, for example, we want to do a different way of electing vestry members. Well, what's the first place you should go to?
Bylaws,
yeah. In theory, the bylaws are going to be consistent with all the canonical structures. So just check your bylaws. You know, and this is one of those places that, you know, that adage, it's better to ask for forgiveness and permission, might not apply. Obedience, and so care, obedience, and then loyalty. And loyalty is, I think, they're all equally important, but it may be the one that trips us up the most. When you become a vestry member, we often think that I have become a vestry member to represent my congregation. And this is part with the confusion around representative government that we all think we're a part of. But you are asked to take the role in making the decisions on behalf of. And you take that role as one of a whole. So where I found over the years loyalty at this level of governance breaking down, and y'all may never have seen anything like this. Where a vestry member is a part of a discussion to let's say change the color of this sanctuary to pink. Okay. And it's a unanimous decision, or it's a unanimous decision, but you wanted it to be baby blue and you voted no. And you leave that meeting. And everybody in the congregation by Monday evening knows that you thought it should have been baby blue. That may seem like an incidental thing, but that is a breakdown in loyalty. Your gift is to participate in that conversation and to express your views. And then when a decision is corporately made, the value of being loyal to the group going forward is essential. Another way it can happen, and I think this can happen in a lot of different ways, but let's pick a very specific example. You as a vestry have made a very tough decision to let a person go who works for the church. And it's controversial, and a reporter calls. And you didn't think it was a good idea, and you tell that reporter it was a bad idea. That is a spectacular way that, if you will, disloyalty to the actions of the corporation creates and mars the body. You may be right, and everybody else may have been wrong, but you need to trust the processes to work that out. So those three duties, keeping them squarely in mind, are highly important to building the trust and to have the authority to do the work of leadership in the church. Now, with that said, balance is important. We live in a strange time. I guess everybody's, we're in the 17th century. People say, oh, we live in a strange time. You know, it's always, because times are always changing, it always feels vulnerable. But the time we're in right now is, I think, challenging in variant ways for people in church leadership. And with those challenges become opportunities. Some of you all have heard me opine this way before, but let me just say it again. The big shift that we're moving through is away from institutionalism. And if you go back 60, 70 years, take as your marker 1946. World War II has just ended, and we're trying to figure out how to be as a country and really as a global Western enterprise or enterprises. What we began to do is to get highly organized and highly structural in our responses. The Pentagon has just been built, okay? And that's sort of one of those outward and visible signs of what it looks like. Europe is a disaster. And what do we do because Europe is a disaster and falling apart? The Marshall Plan. Marshall Plan is an organized institutional response. NATO is an organized institutional response. But what does the church do? Same thing. All the so-called mainline denominations are getting highly structured, and one might even say bureaucratic in this season. And you know what? It works. The church grows tremendously from 1945-46 to 1964-ish. And then the 1960s happens and things get a little curious again. But that time and that experience still informs us so much. But use the 60s as a pivot point, a tipping point. What's the 60s like? What's happening in the 60s? Do anybody remember? Some of you don't want to. Okay. That's just what they're telling you. I don't believe it. Questioning what? Questioning authority. Do your own thing. Drug, sex, and rock and roll. You were there. Okay. Somebody way back here. What?
Cultural revolution.
Civil rights. Civil rights what? Women's what? Gay and lesbian rights what? So we had these movements beginning, right? And so we begin to see, actually in Technicolor, a shift from the age of institutions to the age of movements. Now, when you hear Bishop Curry, Michael Curry, talking about The Jesus Institution. That's how he says it. He says the Jesus Movement. He is echoing what we are experiencing. Now, the good news is it's also incredibly biblically solid, because there was this guy named Jesus who started a... Right. He didn't start the church as an institution. He didn't say, go ye into all the world and write constitutions and canons and bylaws and elect vestries. No, he said, go in the world and proclaim the gospel. Now, the reality is that to do that well, order is important, and the church evolves. And I'm not suggesting that we need to devolve. We need to adapt and take on the character that is resonant with what's happening. And the good news is that it is absolutely consistent to who and whose we are. The chart you have behind you here, some of y'all I know have seen this before, and I'm indebted to Ken Callahan, who shared this with me in a group probably 20 years ago maybe, and when we were really kind of getting our head around this, beginning to. And what Ken would say is, and let's look at this list a little bit. In the church, movements, and parallelism, have one characteristic and institutions another. And I'll test this with you to see if you think it's real or accurate. That if you have a movement in a church, it's going to be local in its feel. It's going to be have a congregational community feeling to it, and if you're really more institutional, it's going to be denominationally labeled. I'll give you an example. In churches across the land, there are movements starting. People look into their communities and say something needs to happen here. People are not being fed. And so a church becomes a center for feeding. The institutional response, and the church, by the way, begins to grow, right? Because it has a mission, it has passion, et cetera, et cetera. Evangelism occurs because of the missional activity at the congregational level. The institution says we need to grow and evangelize, and so we have the decade of evangelism. How'd that work for us? Okay. Movements have a family character. Institutions are concerned about membership. Movements are relational. Institutions are functional. You see it going, on and on. Go down the list. Flexible versus bylaws. This is a continuum, okay? One is more in the world. One's inside the institution. Let me dwell on that last one. In the world institution. If you go to a new town for vacation and you say on Sunday morning, I want to go to a church, and you look up in the phone book, well, you won't look up in the phone book, will you? No. Okay, you Google and you get it, and you're driving down the street, what are you hoping to see a couple of blocks to make sure you're almost there? What's the sign going to say? What? The Episcopal Church welcomes you. Which side of the ledger are you going to put that on? The movement side or the institution side? Institution. The Episcopal Church welcomes you means you have to go into the Episcopal Church, into the building, into the four squares. It's an institutional response. What would it look like if it's a movement? It's going to be the church where? Out in the world, somehow outside of its buildings. Doesn't mean buildings are unimportant. It doesn't mean what we do here is unimportant, but it means that we expect a continuum. What Callahan said a couple decades ago, and I think it's still gospel day, is there are two different kinds of ages. There are the ages of institutions and there are the ages of missions, of movement, excuse me. And we are definitely now rock solid in an age of movements. The political environment we're in right now The Tea Party, and I think there's a shift on the other side of the political spectrum. They are behaving the way they are because they're living their political realities in an age of movements. Okay, the Democratic and the Republican Party are pulling the so-called establishment are pulling the hair out because they're over here on institution. That you can look at all sorts of corporations are going to have are having the same thing. Apple is a movement. Go check their stock out. Exxon is an institution. Go check their stock out. It's same sort of thing, et cetera, et cetera. So, in this age of movements, what Ken would say is you need to have about 70% the characteristic of a movement to thrive, and perhaps about 30% the characteristic of an institution. And the wisdom here, and the reason I can talk about bylaws and duties of trusteeship, is we need some of that. We need some of that, but we also need to have the nimble quality in the spirit of movement, or we are not going to thrive, and in fact, we might not survive. Make sense? Okay. So. Sure.
That the movement that I found fascinating was the civil rights movement because it was churches and church figures responding to the world and working in the world. So I question a little bit the polarized nature.
Right. Let me just to address that again. Say this is a continuum. Nobody ever gets calcified. If you get calcified any place, you're going to get in trouble. If you go to the civil rights movement and you look at how, for example, the different entities, the student movement, etc. When they became more institutional, that's when they got into trouble. They struggled with that institutionalization of their movements, and that's when they actually got pretty cranky and started kicking people like John Lewis out of leadership and stuff like that. So to be attentive to this, and even actually you could have conversations at a vestry or bishop's committee level. Where are we? And where you want to be is not at the extremes for darn tootin' sure, and somewhere to the right of the middle is what I think Callahan would suggest in my senses as well. But if you go too far one way or the other, you're going to be in trouble. You'll get if you go all the way over here, you're going to be just spending all your time worrying about rules and all that, and you're going to have no personality or life. If you're all the way over here, you're going to have no form. You're just going to be, all things to all people. And that won't be good either. So I've seen y'all try and take pictures of this. Why don't we see if we can get this on the website with Clay, and I need to give credit to Ken Callahan when I do that. So let me talk a couple minutes about relationship between bishop and congregation. When I say bishop, I want to depersonalize this in the sense that I want to frame this as episcopate. And when I use the word episcopate, I mean the function of episcopate, of broadly read oversight, the root of that word, is if we took any denomination, any part of the body of Christ, from a UCC congregational level, to a Baptist church level, to a Roman Catholic church, an Episcopal church level, we would be able to discern the charism of oversight, the episcopate. And in our tradition, the root of our denominational name, somehow that didn't make good sense to continue calling ourselves the Church of England in the late 18th century. I don't know why that wasn't as popular. But the idea was to say we were going to be a church with bishops, and That was a radical thing, really, in the late 18th century, because they had not had the experience in the Church of England of having bishops. And it's an extraordinary thing that they anchored their identity on being the Protestant Episcopal Church in the United States of America, and began to elect and have bishops consecrated. Why? For the function of oversight, to be connective tissue. And that has evolved. Now, and part of the evolution and the yin and the yang, the give and the take, has been, I think, around this whole dynamic. And also how technology and transportation, these other things, have affected the relational qualities of life in general. But here we are in the 21st century, in a changing church where the quality of movement and institution are in play. And you have bishops who, people who personify this role of being, what are some of the things we call bishops? Oh, this is dangerous. Maybe I don't want to know. Actually, I probably do know some of them.
Chief pastor.
Chief pastor. Okay. Thank you. guardians of the faith.
Right, Reverend Sir.
Right, Reverend Sir. Okay. Huh?
Shepherd.
Okay. That's, you know, my stomach quit while I'm ahead. but there's an expectation of some sort of relationship. You might hear a cleric might say disciplinarian. You might say somebody might, who's had an experience of strong oversight, a congregation where there has been an intervention by a bishop and the Episcopal team. You know, you might get some more pejorative language, tough person, or et cetera, et cetera. And this is a reflection after 12 years of being in this role, and 4 years before that of being the canon to the ordinary chief of staff for another bishop, is that everybody in this vocation, this sort of continuum, is how much autonomy or flexibility do you give or maintain to how much oversight? And what's absolutely clear to probably everybody in this room is too much of one side or the other is not good. And so where you inhabit that middle range is always the art, not science. And I think that I want to give you that thought today and even see where that hits you, because in a way I know that better entering into my 13th year than I certainly did in my first year. And in our future as the Diocese of San Diego, you're going to have somebody entering into their first year pretty soon. And my God, give that person a break. Permit them to make mistakes and to have a learning curve, and to be able to work with you to find in varying and different situations that sweet spot. What I have learned over the years is there is such a thing as trying too hard to fix somebody else's problem, when the best people to fix the problem are the people whose problem it is. The struggle you get into is, when is their problem not getting fixed going to become problem of the greater community, and working on that very carefully and tenderly, working in, you know, chief pastor, to be the chief pastor shepherd, but knowing it sometimes that what that means is to say, no, stop it, that sort of thing. And I'm saying all this almost retrospectively in hopes that you, as leaders about to be leaders in your several congregations in a time of transition, can remember this and take it into the next episcopate as a place of understanding and patience and deep, deep goodwill. Fair enough? Okay. Building on that, I want to just caution, make a couple cautions. before cautions, one of the great gifts of being the Episcopal Church goes something like this. And I hear this at the House of Bishops. Sort of a harangue that our church is so parochial. Parochial, we're concerned about what happens only here, and nobody cares about what we're doing at the diocese, et cetera, et cetera. And I hear that, and I represent that position from time to time. But the longer I've been at this, the more I think we've got this thing really artfully constructed. And it goes something like this. We are connected. You all are all here not because of your parochialism, right? You're here because there's connections. And there'll be more connections at the end of the day than at the beginning of the day. We have the capacity to speak as one voice. Now, I know when we speak as one voice, there are dissenting opinions, but we do have the capacity to be more than our several parts. We also have the gift of parochialism. And this is where I'm sort of pushing back on that sort of denigration of parochialism. And here's the positive of parochialism is, or being parochial, being cemented in a place, in a space, is what the church needs to be in Yuma is different from what it needs to be in Hemet, what it needs to be in Temecula, what it needs to be in Vista, what it needs to be in Pacific Beach, what it needs to be in Chula Vista, what it needs to be in the center of San Diego. Good news! We got people figuring that out in all those places I just mentioned and a whole bunch of others. And so we have the ability to ask deep questions about local context. That's parochial. That's good. And yet we don't get we need to not be siloed. And that's sort of the shadow side of our structure is we do have always to be avoided this tendency to get our blinders on, to think only about what's going on in our particular congregation, to see those on the outside as outside, and therefore a threat. We've had congregations do SWOT analyses that I don't know if I was supposed to see them when they said the diocese was a threat. But that's how it was, and I need to honor that. That's how it was felt in their parochialism. And so therein lies the challenge, is how do you honor that identity and break down the sense that the threat, and the threat goes something like this, they're going to come in for X, Y, and Z, and that may be a perception, it may not be a reality, but that's what, am I telling you anything you don't know? Okay. This is the thing that in a time that you're about to be gifted, you all can talk about. Is how do we do this? How do we charge somebody to do episcopate, to be the bishop, and bishop with the different accoutrements, the standing committee, the executive council, the staff? How do we entrust others to this work of oversight on our behalf where we let them do that work, even when it's scary for us or threatening? And how do we contend when that happens in a way that is graceful, and constructive, and healthy? So, keep that, if you would, in mind. And here's the meat of what I want to do with you all. I might just stop and see, did that raise anything you want to just kind of go deeper on? Anybody? Right, no way, I'm going to touch that with a tent. Okay, somebody will.
I'm thinking about during these transitions that both parties will pass in the night again and again. And we need to do that with some true care. Mm-hmm. With the hope we can get from God, mm-hmm. and the grace that extends to each other.
Yeah.
We have to be very active.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I would agree with that. Yeah, thank you. All right. So I'm going to... How are we doing on time? I'm okay, right? I'm all right. I've got, you know, God gave Moses the Ten Commandments. And I think God gave us, or is giving us, at least this is how I got it today, 10 ways to health and community. 10 things to do to be healthier in community. And again, thinking about where we were going as a church, I think if I was doing this 12 years ago when I first came, and I would do probably 10 ways to grow your church. And I would be focusing on get more people in the church. Get your pledges up. And you all may wish that I would do that today. I don't, again, I go back to the Gospels. Nowhere does Jesus say, I'm sending you out 2 by 2 to go get a higher average Sunday attendance. However, I think if we work on being healthy, the things that preoccupy us will take care of themselves. If you want to feel good as a body, you need to do what? Have healthy habits. You need to exercise. You need to eat well. You need to have good night's sleep. You know, we could come up with our 10 best things to do, and you would feel good. If you want to go run a marathon, please don't do it tomorrow. But you might come up with, we might come up with a list of 10 things you're going to do over the next 6 months so you actually survive that marathon. So this is what I got for you. And I'm going to unpack these a little bit as we go along. The first is be really clear about what your mission is. And again, you have the ability to be specific in a location. You don't have to be all things to all people in a congregational setting. You can craft how you are the Episcopal Church in your particular place. What does that look like? Well, it's looking deeply at what your gifts and talents are, right? I mean, if you're going to be doing mission in a particular place, you're going to want to start with who are you and what are your capacities, and then you're going to want to look honestly at the mission field. What surrounds you? When I was in Northfield, Northfield is North Shore, Chicago. Y'all all been there, actually. Everybody seen Ferris Bueller's Day Off? Okay. The high school, Northfield. That was at that point was a mothballed high school. It's now in use again. So Ferris Bueller went to school in Northfield. The water tower next door, community of Northbrook, save Ferris. Okay. If some of y'all don't know what I'm talking about, Netflix. That's your entertainment for tonight. My piano teacher, Ferris Bueller ran through her backyard to try to get home before his father. See, I'm not making this stuff up. This is all true. John Hughes grew up in that area. Very much an affluent upper middle class area. And we struggled to find our voice around outreach, around servant ministry. And one day, I was up with the kids at a little strip mall, Zany Brainy. It was this toy store. Came out, we were getting a gift for, I think, a birthday present or something like that for a friend of one of my kids. And a fellow came up to me and asked me, he was asking me for money. He said, "You got a dollar?" Which I did, which I gave him. And something, you know, the little voice said, "Say more." So I said, "Share with me why you need a dollar." And he said, "I want a Coke. They only give us $30 a month." Well, who's they? He began to tell me that he lived in nursing home across the way. Well, this guy's in his 30s. Well, it turns out he was HIV positive, was indigent. Cook County had taken that nursing facility and Lake Cook Healthcare Center, which was behind a fence behind this strip mall, and were warehousing people in both facilities. So the idea was born. We began, went to that first nursing home. They didn't know what to do with us. We went to the other one and said, what could we do to help you all? And the director of the nursing home brought out her guest register and turned to Christmas Day, of the previous Christmas Day, and one person had come to visit 125 people. And what was born was ministries called Levi's Table, which was a ministry of companionship for this, whoever were the residents. And it's going on to this day. They long since hired a part-time deacon to be the chaplain. They bring people to church who are able to come to church. That community is considered a part of the parish. And all this time, we didn't know that they were there. So know your mission field. Know your gifts, what your capacities are, and find your mission and articulate it well. Be clear about your mission. What gets us in trouble? It's hard to be a community, right? Communities are tough. It's tough. Citizenship is tough. We're finding that in our nation, if we didn't know it already. Citizenship in the kingdom of God is tough. We bruise each other. We practice our humanity in spectacular technicolor sometimes. What I have sensed over the years is that working diligently on practicing direct communication is our best way. Now, we have a phrase in the church, it comes out of Scripture, speak the truth in love. Now, there are times when I really clearly hear the truth, but not so much the love. And I'm sure you've had that experience as well. Don't talk at people, but with them. And the talking may be more listening most of the time. When things get awry, go south. When we're doing this, when you want to say, I can't hear you because you're talking so loudly, it's time to take a breath. We Episcopalians have a wonderful gift. If I said, the Lord be with you, what would you say? What is a great thing to do after that? Pray. If things are getting awry in a vestry meeting, I now charge and empower every vestry member, every bishop's committee member in this diocese to do just that, to say, to bid people to prayer, and actually pray. Let the Spirit move you. Don't use prayer as a weapon, by the way. I pray that Tom Morelli will finally figure out how damn wrong he is. I'm being very unsubtle on that, but there are all these subtle ways of using prayer and Scripture as a cudgel. You don't want to do that, but creating space for God actually to unveil God's presence and to move in that way. You all know what I mean by triangling. Triangling is work. It's used a lot because it is so delicious. If I have a beef with you, the direct communication would be to talk to you directly. But it's a lot more fun to come over here and say, you know what? And then you go over to her and say, well, Jim has been saying that, and you're like, and you don't come to me, you come over to Karen. And you see, we got these multiple triangles. And what does that do to community? It just rips it apart. So when triangles occur, I come to do this. Tom, at his best, would say, I think you need to go over and talk to her. Or he does this, you can say, I think you need to go back to Jim and tell him to come and talk to me directly. Invite direct conversation and communication. I cannot tell you how many hours upon hours this will save if this can happen. Be hard on the issues, but soft on people. Expect and tolerate conflict. The reason this happens is I don't have to be in conflict with you if I talk about you over here. I can unload my stuff, but keep out of direct conflict with you. So These are just ways to build health. I mentioned something about prayer. We are, this is number three, we are a community bound together by common prayer. I commend it to you, by the way. It's a great book. It's got to be a bestseller, right? The Book of Common Prayer. To take our worship extraordinarily seriously. And I often have said, take it seriously, but don't take yourselves too seriously. It's the act of coming together in corporate worship that we need to be disciplined and bring our best selves to. But when things kind of go off the rails, you can laugh about it a little bit. God will laugh with you. And we do this to create a space in our weekly life, really in all facets, where we can not just check prayer off a list. You know, the way it looks often is you have a vestry meeting and you open it with prayer and you end with prayer. The book ends. But what about the space of prayer to allow God's presence to be felt and to make our times together be times of discernment? There's a difference, I guess, between reaching a decision because we've got to make a decision and discerning, weighing carefully what is the way forward. And valuing spiritual gifts in that discernment process, the gifts of each and every person in this room, the gifts of the those who are ordained in their particular charisms. Going back to my years in Northfield, I remember a story, a moment where we had the Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat came to town. Great musical. And at intermission, a parishioner grew up in the parish, was now a Sunday school teacher, came up to me and said, "When does Mary show up?" Wrong Joseph. Wrong Joseph. That was a delicate moment. How do I... Y'all get it, don't you? How do you say wrong Joseph without making her feel bad? And I can't for the life of me remember what I did at that moment, but it must be like blocking it out. But that was a real important moment for me to recognize how serious we were disconnected with our being a community of learning. Sunday school teachers were... We were filling holes with whoever would take that role, regardless of what their gifts were. And we were not giving serious attention to formation at the youngest ages, and we were totally out. We were not doing anything on substantive formation of ourselves. Vestry members, bishops' committee members, here's a question for you. Are you a community of learning? Are you a learning, growing community? Do you create space and time for the ordained leadership serving you to have time for study and reflection? Do you help them do continuing education? Do you do it yourself? Do you form and educate each other, like Leadership Academy? Do you read a book together? Does your congregation take seriously that lifelong Christian formation is an essential part of growing in faith? Don't you want your doctors to do that? Don't you want them to keep learning about the newest medications and procedures? Don't you want your clergy to do it? And don't you want your kids, Sunday school teachers, to do it? And isn't it a good thing for everybody to grow? If we grow as leaders and members of the body of Christ, guess what's going to grow? Yeah, the body of Christ. So, learning communities. Now, I said I'd come back here. Talking about the canons, I said something about those, they're good boundaries. So talked about this thing being a vessel. We have in our opening hymn, being a vessel, something that was molded by God. We have boundaries to our churches, and I don't just mean the walls. Parker Palmer, beautiful book he's written, is Quaker. Actually, he's probably, I think he's an Episcopalian, but he actually says he's a Quaker. Everybody I like is an Episcopalian. Some of them just don't know it yet. But he wrote a beautiful book called The Courage to Teach, and has a whole series of what he talks about as paradoxes for a safe and gifted learning environment. And I think they translate to the religious centers and the body of Christ perfectly. And to the point I want to make is this one. He talks about the necessity of being open and bounded. So to be a healthy community, we need to be open and bounded. We talk a lot about all are welcome. Right? All are welcome. And we get into some of our big struggles as a church over the quality and characteristics of that welcomeness. To some, all are welcome is game, set, match without any discussion. Others would say, wait a second, what are the bounds of that? There are no bounds to welcome. When they're, in a sense, that's true. But they're bounds to the community. If I said to you, I want you to go into a classroom and there's no structure to it, how comfortable will you likely be in that classroom? That there's no rules or no, there are no parameters whatsoever. Same with a church. We have bounds. We have boundaries. We call them our creeds and our, as this word again, constitution and canons. We have structures that create just or almost just enough bounds so that we know who we are and how we are, but not so much that they're impermeable. They're like a membrane that allows breathing and for inclusion. So openness is important. All are welcome is important, but all are welcome into something. And we define it by who we say we are, who we see God to be, and what God is doing in our lives. We'll still debate it, and we'll debate the characteristic, and again, where we are in that paradox of being bounded and open. That's fair game. That's discernment. That's part of being a learning community. But we need to be open and bounded. Now, always tell the truth. As I said earlier, speak the truth in love, but speak the truth. If you speak the truth in hate, I don't think you're speaking the truth. I really don't. Because Jesus said what? I am the truth. And so if the truth that you speak is laced with hate, from a theological perspective, there's no truth within it. We cannot be people of the way and intentionally make falsehoods or be careless in our relationship with the truth. The danger of self-denial and self-deception needs to be a part of that too. Too often the truth we're not telling is not to another person, but to ourselves. Now for a leadership role that you may be playing, this is really important. You need to tell the truth to those you're working with. to your congregants, to your bishop, to those who you do business with. That's going to build your credibility as an individual and as a congregation. Can anybody think of a place where, as a church, we have failed in this? Anybody see the movie Spotlight?
Yes.
Yeah. And even though that was about the Roman Catholic Church, those who live in glass houses should not throw stones. The Episcopal Church and every church has a history of not telling the truth on times when it really was on the line. Now, with that said, that was number six, if y'all are keeping track of these. Number seven is intimately related to it. It's important that we know the difference between keeping confidences and keeping secrets. Now, I want to unpack this one a little bit, but this is really, really important and subtle, and it relates to vestry work and leadership work in a lot of different ways. There are times when things need to be made remain confidential. Anybody have an example? Dismissal of an employee. Yeah, you have anything around, I would say, human resources. This is where you get into the, we're also a corporation. You need to be very attentive to those expectations of law and of just good decorum. How about others? Right, right. Pastoral matters that just need to be kept confidential. We could go on and on and probably come up with several. Certain business matters, that might be being entertained by a vestry. You're thinking about purchasing a piece of property next door. You're probably not going to share that your in open session. What you're thinking about for an asking price and what your bottom line is going to be for reasons of business safety. Secrets, and this is where I want to be really a nuance here, are very different from confidences. Secrets are they're in the shadows. Secrets are hidden, and keeping secrets does not build up the body. But they are used for shaming, and they're retained to increase power, to maintain power or increase power, or they are a manifestation of a deep dysfunction. Let me give you some examples of here. A young person has been sexually abused, and she keeps that secret because she's ashamed. It remains in the shadow. Now, the abuser of the same person uses that secret as power over, power retained, power leveraged. A group of parishioners knows that somebody has really screwed up, and they keep that a secret and occasionally make it known that they know, so they have power over that person. Maybe that person is the rector. The alcoholic hides his drinking. A dysfunction is masked. I'm being reminded of the time. Okay. So, this is what you call excellent staff work. Thank you, Allison. So in summary, no. I'm going to get through the 10, and I have a couple more things. But alcoholic hides his drinking. And the dysfunction is masked. All these things stay in the darkness. You go to Scripture, John's gospel, you will know the truth, and the truth will what? Make you free. Luke writes words of Jesus, for nothing is hidden that will not be disclosed, nor is anything secret that will not be known. And here's the money quote, and come to light. Healthy congregations don't keep secrets. They know the difference between a confidence and a secret. And that makes a huge difference. Number eight, develop a capacity to be well ordered. You know, the old thing, people say they don't want to be involved in organized religion. And I want to sometimes say, join the Episcopal Church, we're always disorganized, you know. Which is not, it's sort of a, gets a laugh, but that's not the way we should be. Jesus organized ministry, sent us out two by two. He gathered folks on the mount in companies to be fed. There's always an organizational element to the activity of Jesus in the Gospels. He's always bringing order out of what? Chaos. I mean, think of the storm on the sea. And the early church created structures and ordered ministries and created accountability. And so we should do the same. Vestries, bishops' committees, you have the responsibility of the temporal affairs of the church, not a light and casual thing. It should be exercised with the utmost care for the spiritual affairs of the church. That includes things like well-being, well-maintained property, good budget practices. Here's something, real quick and easy way to see if you're having a healthy budget. This much money coming in, that amount needs to be the same as the money going out. Okay? Okay, I just did. As my kids would say, just saying. Really, I mean, and I know some of you are saying, but that's not where we are, that's not a reality. If you don't do that, it's not going to work. You've got to fix that. You've got to fix that. That's well ordered. That's good church administration. Change. A capacity to change. And by capacity to change, I'm thinking of a capacity to engage change and be the artful administrator and governor of that change. The reality is, the change is going to happen. This goes back to telling the truth to yourself. Are you going to be a participant in the change, or are you going to be a subject to it? It's not playing the victim as church, okay? When people play the victim, when they let themselves be not the author of their story, but a subject in somebody else's story, that's not healthy. And the same is true with churches. Change is always in the air with something we should not be afraid of, something we should embrace. We talk about being fearless followers of Jesus' life, and that is embracing change. The right kind of change, and trusting God in the midst of this. And I'm going to end with number 10. And number 10 is probably number 1 through 9 in many respects. Be a community of the cross. I'm going to say that again because it's so important. Right? Be a community of the cross. Understand and honor the cycle of life and death as a necessary part of the resurrection story. Martin Luther King Jr. said this, and I think this is, you know, as we say in my business, this will preach. There are some things so dear, some things so precious, some things so eternally true that they are worth dying for. And I submit to you that if a man has not discovered something that he will die for, he isn't fit to live. Francis, in a prayer attributed to him, for it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. And our own John Hines, the late presiding bishop of the Episcopal Church, who brought us through the civil rights movement and won peace, The church can only exercise an authority if it bears in its body the marks of our Lord Jesus, if it has itself been crucified in the marketplace, unless it is as just as it proclaims its gospel to be. So we need to be willing to have the marks of the crucified, be a church that's willing to go to the cross. That is a church that's in the world, that's in the marketplace, that takes risks, and is a real presence of Jesus, that is Eucharist for the world. Now I guess I got, 7 minutes? Okay, what do we got?
It's 23 over.
Yeah.
You're 23 over.
Is that it?
Yeah, we need to end at 11.
You need to end at 11. See, Glenn, that's not so bad. We're not going to have discussion time. I sort of flavored that in. So this, if y'all want to have discussion, have lunch with me afterwards, okay? But let me just say, it's a quick word and try and do this in a couple minutes. I want to talk about my leave-taking, and this is not going to be easy. Let's talk about baseball instead. What do you say? I am not, this is not easy, okay? And I was never going to be one of those bishops who was going to leave this diocese for another diocese. Why would I? It's not the weather, folks. Why would I? This is the best diocese I know of. And, you know, I feel like I got sweat equity in this thing, okay? And so it's born out of love and deep respect. But sometimes you got to give up the role to let God do what's going to happen next for you and for those you serve. And I came to a sense in engaging a conversation this was the time. And I always thought, oh, wouldn't it be cool to be in that academic place as sort of my last act? And the opportunity came, and golly, it happened. I couldn't move Virginia Seminary to San Diego. I couldn't figure out how to do it. So I have to leave. And it's for a variety of reasons, many personal, very challenging. You all will elect a fifth bishop. And God willing, at that, I will be a subordinate, helpful person to that next bishop, whoever he or she may be. That may be staying as far away as possible, and Virginia is not too bad for that. It may be different, but it will be dependent on the fifth bishop, and I will do everything I can for that person to have a spectacular success. That's what we're supposed to do, is we're supposed to have our successor's success should be our primary concern. And that's what it means to be a person in transition, always taking up what's been given to you and handing it off for the greater glory of God. I will still be a bishop. I will still be your bishop, but it will be former bishop. You will be given the enormous responsibility as community to elect my successor in convention. That's done by a vote of orders, the clergy order and the lay order. Jim Stiven, I saw him here, as a member of the standing committee, and the standing committee will step in and take jurisdiction until that election. They're working now to figure out the contours of that time after June 30 and a new bishop is in place on how they will manage things. But you need to be at peace. You need to understand, I invite you all to understand that, or I invite you to consider that all will be well. That this is actually a pretty reasonable time to, with me still in place, to get things in place for things to happen. And you've done this before. And it was harder before than it's going to be this time. Things are different. They're better. And it's because of you. So I'm going to end right on time. I'm deeply in love with this community, and that will always be true. I am leaving at least one child behind. His child, he's 31 years old. But who knows? This may be our retirement home. We'll figure that out in the fullness of time. But I'll always be with you in heart and soul and prayer. And I love you. And this is my constant. I'm not dead yet. So I'm your bishop until June 30th. So thank you all.